أن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم. وبعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله، وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل دلالة في النار. أما بعد، you should know, dear brothers and sisters in Al-Islam, that the scholars of this deen, the fuqaha of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, have mentioned some things about Sharia rulings, which in general dictate the obligation to protect what those scholars have called al-Dururiyat al-Khams, the five essentials of life. And they have derived these five essentials, or these Dururiyat al-Khams, to make sure that those five things are safe and secure. Those five things are the religion, the life, the honor, the person himself, or their mental health, as some say, and their wealth. These five things have to be protected, and they are protected by Islam and by the Sharia. And one of the five essentials, which the text of the Quran and the authentic Sunnah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam indicate must be preserved, and on which the Ummah is unanimously agreed, is the preservation of human life, which comes second only to the preservation of the deen itself or the religion. The basic principle for the Muslim is that he obeys or she obeys whatever Allah enjoins upon him or her, and they refrain from whatever Allah has forbidden for them. And whatever the reason is, they don't ask. They just obey. They carry out those things that are obligatory upon them, and they stay far away from those things that have been made unlawful, whether the reason for doing it is clear or not. And it is not permissible for a Muslim to reject any ruling of the Sharia or to hesitate in following it if the reason behind it is not crystal clear to them. But rather, the Muslim must accept the rulings of the lawful and the prohibited when they have a proof in the text and the divinely revealed text, that is the Book of Allah, the Noble Quran, and the authenticated Sunnah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whether he understands the reason behind it or not. For Allah Jalla Jalaluhu says in his book, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ وَمَنْ يَعْصِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا مُبِينًا. It is not befitting for a believer, male or female, when Allah and His Messenger has decided a matter, that they should have any option in their decision. And whoever disobeys Allah and His Messenger, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi wa barakatuh, he has indeed strayed into a plain, clear error. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in another place in His book, إِنَّمَا كَانَ قَوْلَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَا بَيْنَهُمْ أَنْ يَقُولُوا سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. The only saying of the faithful believers when they are called to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam to judge between them is that they say, سمعنا وأطعنا. We hear and we obey, and those are the people who are successful, meaning they are the ones who will be in paradise forever. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with many attributes and many job descriptions. And from amongst those descriptions that he has to fulfill, and he fulfilled them, Allah says about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, يَأْمُرُهُمْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَاهُمْ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَيُحِلُّ لَهُمُ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَيُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْخَبَائِثَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commands them with the ma'roof, with all those things that Allah has ordained. And he forbids them from the munkar, which is disbelief and polytheism of all kinds, and all kinds of shirk and kufr, and all the things that Islam has forbidden. And he allows them the tayyibat, all the things that are good, all the things that are lawful with regard to their deeds and their actions and their beliefs and their persons and their food and their drinks and their clothing. And he prohibits them all the things that are al-khaba'ith, which are all the evil, filthy, disgusting, unlawful things regarding deeds and beliefs and persons and foods and drinks and clothing. The ulama of tafsir, they say that the khaba'ith are all the things that will harm a person's wealth, a person's health, and a person's morals, in any and every single thing that leads to negative consequences in one of those important aspects of a person's life, that is al-dururiyatul khams, those five essential things, comes under the general heading of al-khaba'ith. The general meaning of that verse includes the reason for the prohibition on smoking cigarettes. And it may be understood, brothers and sisters in al-Islam, that the Islamic viewpoint with regard to smoking cigarettes is that it falls under the category of al-khaba'ith. And one of the many reasons of which smoking cigarettes falls under the category of al-khaba'ith and not the tayyibat, the good thing, but rather the evil thing, the filthy thing, the disgusting thing, the harmful thing, the unlawful thing, is that it is a slow suicide. For Allah says in His book, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُمْ رَحِيمًا وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ عُدْوَانًا وَظُلْمًا فَسَوْفَ نُصْلِيهِ نَارًا وَكَانَ ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَصِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in His book, the interpretation of the meaning of the ayah, and do not, and this is a commandment to stay away from it, and do not kill yourselves, for indeed Allah is most merciful to you. وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Do not kill yourselves, for indeed Allah has been merciful to you. And whoever commits that through aggression and injustice, we shall cast them into the fire, and that is easy for Allah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in an authentic hadith, he said, لا ضرر ولا ضرار. Let there be no harm, nor this reciprocation of harm. Let there be no harming, that is, we should not harm other Muslims, or harm even the non-Muslims, or harm the animals, or harm the plants, or harm the environment, nor should we allow anyone to harm us. Brothers and sisters in al-Islam, the non-Muslims of this government, of the United States of America, in 1966, on the side of the package of cigarettes, those things that we call colloquially cancer sticks, those things that we call coffin nails, those things that the person who's smoking it fire on one end and a fool on the other end. The United States government on the side of the pack of cigarettes in 1966, they had this note, caution, cigarette smoking may be hazardous to your health. That was over 40 years ago. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent his bounty upon the human being, not just the Muslim, but upon the human being, non-Muslims also, and had them to investigate. And in 1970, just 4 years later, they removed that notice on the side of the pack of cigarettes, and they placed it with, or replaced it, warning. The Surgeon General has determined that cigarette smoking is dangerous to your health. A few years later, Surgeon General's warning, smoking causes lung cancer, heart disease, emphysema, and may complicate pregnancy. About 7 years later, Surgeon General's warning, quitting smoking now greatly reduces serious risk to your health. A few years after that, they replace it with this statement, Surgeon General's warning, smoking by pregnant women may result in fetal injury, premature birth, and low birth weight. Then right after that, in 2006, Surgeon General's warning, cigarette smoke contains carbon monoxide. And one of the most astounding, amazing things that I have ever seen in my life as a Muslim is a doctor that smokes cigarettes. Even more amazing than that is a Muslim that smokes cigarettes. And even more astounding than that, fire on one end and a fool on the other end of the cigarette is a Muslim doctor smoking cigarettes. I have never seen something so astounding in my life. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, your body has rights over you, and there's no disagreement among the physicians and those people that have wisdom that cigarette smoking is harmful for the health of the person who does it and the person who inhales it, called the passive smoker. There are nearly 4,000 chemicals in a cigarette. Listen closely, brothers. Oh, you fools on the other end of the fire. You stupid Muslims who harm yourselves and waste your money and have the nerve to even do it right after the prayer. You stand in front of the masjid and smoke cigarettes. And some of you have the audacity in the month of Ramadan, less than 60 days away, to break your fast. You light up a cigarette. All of that fasting and praying and charity and obedience to Allah, you break your fast with a cigarette? Over 4,000 chemicals, at least 43 of the ingredients in every single cigarette is cancer causing. Acetic acid, which is a corrosive to the respiratory tract. Acetone, which is used in nail polish removers. Ammonia, used in floor and toilet cleaners. Arsenic, which we all know is a poison. Cadmium, which is used for car battery fluid. Carbon monoxide, which interferes with the supply of oxygen in the blood to the rest of the body. DDT, which is insecticide. Ethanol, which is alcohol. Formalin, which is used in preserving human tissue and fabric. Hexamine, which is used in explosive compounds. Hydrogen cyanide, which is another poison. Methane, petroleum gas or sewer gas. Naphthalene, used in mothballs. Nicotine, which may cause death or severe injury if ingested or in contact with the skin or the eyes. Nitrobenzene, which is used in rubber chemicals, pesticides, shoe and floor polishers. Phenol, which is used in disinfectants. Stearic acid, which is used in candle wax. Tolanin, which is used to dissolve paint and paint thinners and rubber and printing ink and vinyl chloride. And all of us should be familiar with vinyl chloride. Because vinyl chloride is the thing that makes that car that's brand new have that brand new car smell. Or that thing that makes the shower curtain, the new shower curtain that gives off that smell. It is a poisonous chemical called PVC. There's no doubt, brothers and sisters in Islam, that there is fire on one end of the cigarette and a fool on the other. As for the offensive smell caused by smoking, it is a source of pain to the worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala amongst the human beings and the angels. And the angels are offended and they suffer from the same thing that the human beings suffer from. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and we know that the angels are believers. And we know that we have jinn who are Muslims who come and pray with us when the azan is called, even if you're in the forest by yourself, or on a mountaintop, or in a desert, as the ulama of Islam, when they took the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said, even if you're by yourself tending to your sheep, with no one around, you should call the azan, for you don't know who from amongst the khalq, or the creation of Allah, meaning the angels and the Muslims from amongst the jinn, who will come to join you in the salah. The angels are offended. Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْذُونَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ بِغَيْرِ مَكْتَسَبُوا فَقَدْ احْتَمَلُوا بُهْتَانًا وَإِثْمًا مُبِينًا. Those who cause harm to the believing men and the believing women without reason do a great sin. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man akala thuman aw batalan fala yaqrubanna masjidana wal yusalli fi baytihi." Whoever eats garlic, which is halal, whoever eats onion, which is halal, whoever eats leeks, which is halal, then he should not, the Prophet ordered you, commanded you, and prohibited you, that if you eat halal garlic, if you eat the garlic that is halal, and all of it is, and eat the onions which are halal, and have benefit, no one will doubt that garlic and onions have benefit for the blood, and benefit for the body itself, but you cannot go to the masjid, he sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, and you should rather, he should rather pray in his house. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in another hadith, إِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَ لَتَتَأَذَّى مِمَّا يَتَأَذَّى مِنْهُ بَنُو الْإِنسَانِ. The angels are offended by the same thing that offend the sons of Adam. How could the person come to the masjid with that filthy, pungent, stenchful, stinking, offensive smell of cigarette upon them and harm the Muslims? For that reason alone, it is haram. Because it is haram to harm the Muslims. The money that is spent on cigarettes is used on buying the harmful thing, the unlawful thing, and therefore it is extravagant. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in his book, وَلَا تُبَذِّرْ تَبْذِيرًا إِنَّ الْمُبَذِّرِينَ كَانُوا إِخْوَانَ الشَّيَاطِينَ وَكَانَ الشَّيْطَانُ لِرَبِّهِ كَفُورًا. And do not be extravagant and wasteful. Those who are extravagant and wasteful are the brothers of the devils. Those who are extravagant and waste their money, they are the brothers of the shayateen. Extravagance, brothers and sisters, israf, is haram in Islam. Because it means here, spending on something that is haram, spending your money on cigarettes is a waste of resources. عن أبي برزة الأسلمي رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تزول قدم عبد يوم القيامة حتى يسأل عن عمره فيما أفناه وعن علمه فيما فعل وعن ماله من أين اكتسبه وفيما أنفقه وعن جسمه, وعن جسمه فيما أبلاه أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. The feet of the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not move on the day of resurrection until he is asked about his life and how he spent it, his knowledge and what he did with it, his wealth and how he earned it and what he spent it on, and his body and what he did with it. If a person spends money on one pack of cigarettes at $3.25, and now it's higher than that. At the end of the year, he will have spent $2,364.18. Just 2 months ago, some of the brothers had an annual Umrah package. They made Umrah, making the Umrah to Allah. That Umrah package was $2,400. $2,400. $3.25 a day, one pack. You could have made Umrah, and some of you have never seen. Some of you have never seen the Kaaba. Some of you have never made Hajj or Umrah. The person who spends $4.20 on two packs of cigarettes at the end of the year will have spent $3,055.20, and you are complaining because you don't have a car. You're complaining because you don't have correct furniture for your wife. The person who smokes two packs of cigarettes at $5 a day, at the end of the year, $3,637.20, wallahu musta'an. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الأمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد. Brothers and sisters in Al-Islam, considering all that we've mentioned in the first part of the khutbah, it can be clearly seen that smoking is an evil among other evils. And it is not permissible to indulge in it, or buy it, or sell it, or even offer it to others, or even light a person's cigarette, or to hand them a match when it is clear that they're going to light up a cigarette. It is incumbent upon every single Muslim who is addicted to this offensive, haram, unlawful act, to give it up, to make every effort whatsoever to give up this offensive habit. With regard to the prohibition on selling cigarettes, then it is prohibited also. For the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ الْيَهُودُ حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ الشُّحُومُ فَبَاعُوهَا وَأَكَلُوا أَثْمَانَهَا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلْ إِذَا حَرَّمَ أَكْلَ الشَّيْءِ حَرَّمَ ثَمْنَهُ. May Allah curse the Jews. Fat was forbidden to them, so they sold it and consumed its price. But when Allah forbids a thing, He also forbids the price. I have personally spoken to people who own these corner stores, and they say, if we don't sell cigarettes, we won't make any money. Because a good portion of the money that we earn is from cigarettes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has answered you and given you the solution. He says, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. Whoever has fear of Allah, they fear Allah properly, Allah will make an exit for them and provide for them from a place they have no expectation. He will provide for them from a place they can't even imagine. And whoever puts their ultimate dependence on Allah, whoever puts their ultimate tawakkul on Allah, then Allah is sufficient for them. I remember about 27 years ago in Brooklyn, New York, when I was living there, I told a brother, stop selling the cigarettes, brother. And he told me, I have to sell the cigarettes. I will not become successful. I have to sell these cigarettes, or I'll lose so much money. Finally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him. He stopped selling the cigarettes. When I returned to Brooklyn and spoke to him, he said, I swear by Allah, Brother Dawood, my wealth has increased 4 times. My wealth has increased 4 times when I stopped selling the cigarettes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forbidden cigarettes by the text of his book and the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If your grandmother or your mother or your father or your aunt ask you to go to the store to buy some cigarettes for them, then you should not obey them. And you should kindly tell them, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forbade this offensive habit. وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالْتَقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Do not help one another, or help one another in acts of righteousness and piety, and do not help one another in sin and transgression. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لَا تَعَتِ لِلْمَخْلُوقِ فِي مَعْثِيَةِ الْخَالِقِ. Let there be no obedience to the creation at the expense of disobeying Allah the Creator. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِنَّمَا الطَّاعَةُ فِي الْمَعْرُوفِ. That obedience is only in the things that are ma'roof, those things that are ordained by Allah. هَذَا وَصَلَى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمْ وَبَارِكْ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدْ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصْحَابِهِ وَسَلَّمْ.